You see, the reason you want to be better is the reason why you aren't. Shall I put it like that? We aren't better because we want to be. Because the road to hell is paved with good intentions. Because all the do-gooders in the world, whether they're doing good for others or doing it for themselves, are troublemakers. On the basis of kindly let me help you or you'll drown, said the monkey, putting the fish safely up a tree. We white Anglo-Saxon Protestants, British, German, American, have been on a rampage for the past 100 or more years to improve the world. We have given the benefits of our culture, our religion, our technology to everybody, except perhaps the Australian Aborigines. And we have insisted that they receive the benefits of our culture, even our political styles, our democracy. You had better be democratic, or we'll shoot you. And having conferred these blessings all over the place, we wonder why everybody hates us. See, because sometimes doing good to others, and even doing good to oneself, is amazingly destructive. Because it's full of conceit. How do you know what's good for other people? How do you know what's good for you? If you say you want to improve, then you ought to know what's good for you. But obviously you don't. Because if you did, you would be improved. So we don't know. It's like the problem of geneticists, which they face today. I went to a meeting of geneticists not so long ago where they gathered in a group of philosophers and theologians and said, now look here, we need help. We now are on the verge of figuring out how to breed any kind of human character we would want to have. We can give you saints, philosophers, scientists, great politicians, anything you want. Just tell us what kind of human beings ought we to breed. So I said, how will those of us who are genetically unregenerate make up our minds what genetically generate people might be? Because I'm afraid very much that our selection of virtues may not work. It may be like, for example, this new kind of high-yield grain which is made, and which is becoming ecologically destructive. When we interfere with the processes of nature and breed efficient plants and efficient animals, there's always some way in which we have to pay for it. And I can well see that eugenically produced human beings might be dreadful. We could have a plague of virtuous people. Do you realize that? Any animal considered in itself is virtuous, it does its thing, but in crowds they're awful. Like a crowd of ants or locusts on the rampage. They're all perfectly good animals, but it's just too much. I could imagine a perfectly pestiferous mass of a million saints. So I said to these people, look, there's the only thing you can do. Just be sure that a vast variety of human beings is maintained. Don't please breed us down to a few excellent types. Excellent for what? We never know how circumstances are going to change and how our need for different kinds of people changes. At one time, we may need very individualistic and aggressive people. At another time, we may need very cooperative, team-working people. At another time, we may need people who are full of interest in dexterous manipulation of the external world. At another time, we may need people who explore into their own psychology and are introspective. There is no knowing, but the more varieties and the more skills we have, obviously, the better. So you see, here again, the problem comes out in genetics. We do not really know how to interfere with the way the world is. The way the world actually is an enormously complex, interrelated organism.
Supposing in the course of time we reach a point in which inwardly we have sensory perceptions that would enable us to judge and estimate practically everything in nature. How would it be if, for instance, we came to a point where there could be in this world no such a thing as a secret? Supposing that we can read everybody's mind. And, of course, everyone is reading ours at the same time. Supposing there'd be no need for concealment and no possibility of it. Well, in our present situation, this would practically result in universal bankruptcy. We can't trust ourselves and we have greater distrust of others. Supposing our politicians could never hide anything from us. Supposing our lawyers couldn't. And supposing we had an understanding of our own lives and our own bodies to the physicians, to the degree that a physician could not make a mistake. And supposing all of this costs nothing because we are born with it. All right, suppose in the same length of time we, and under the same conditions, we reorganize our theory of nutrition. Perhaps our nutritional theory isn't just exactly right. Perhaps the greater part of our nutrition should not come from the earth, but from light, from the power of energies in space. Supposing the individual could survive indefinitely by developing the abilities of his own magnetic field. Supposing he could travel by teleportation. Perhaps every faculty and power that has been fictionally used in magic is natural and possible to him, with a complete regeneration of his motivations. Perhaps then he could realize that the moment he is selfish, this entire world of beauty begins to collapse around him. While he is unselfish, it is there. Freed from a great many things, he doesn't have to be lazy. Today, if we got a little money or something of that nature, we sit down in front of a television set and spend the rest of our time wasting it. Supposing instead of that, this new perspective on things gave us an entirely different orientation to what life was about. That we have countless ways of gaining greater insights, exploring, discovering, enjoying, recognizing the common friendships and kinships of life, and that in a gentle and friendly way we could live with each other. Perhaps under a few of those circumstances we might observe that the need for constant policing and countless legislative protection might greatly diminish. We wouldn't need it.
And the story continues. The body of Osiris, the secret doctrine, is divided into 14 parts. Remember, Osiris was chopped into 14 parts. They found all save one, the phallus or the penis of Osiris. Well, the body of Osiris represents the secret doctrine. It's divided into 14 parts and divided among the parts of the world. And the lost word of Freemasonry is the generative force, the lost part of Osiris, lost part, the secret of the secret doctrine. So we must therefore understand that it was scattered through the seven divine and seven infernal spheres. The locusts and tails of India are by different symbolism to the seven worlds which are without and the seven worlds which are within. The Kabbalah of the Jews. Bacchus was torn into seven pieces by the Titans and Osiris into 14 pieces. To use the words of Faber, quote, both these stories are in substance the same, for the second number is merely the reduplicate of the first. By a variation of much the same nature, the ancient mythologist added seven Titanides and seven Kabiri to the seven Titans, unquote.